An overview. So I want to try to make it possible for makers or hobbyists to make their own ASICs. So you have the comment yesterday also about, yeah, you can do some things on an FPGA, but you may want to make a chip. So first chips wants to be free, my dream. Who is too crazy to do such a project? Then the pilot project, and then I want to ask for some contribution. So I'm coming from the software world, where I followed from the end of the 90s, actually, development of Linux and all these things. You had something called Usenet at the time. I don't know if people remember that. So I was also there. I probably have seen the Usenet post of Linus about Linux, that he was just doing a hobby project, like I'm doing now. Anyway, I don't have any ambition to be the next Linus. But what's happened there is that people, what they could do, they had to just buy a computer and then just they could hack at night to get Linus running. And the only thing they want to do is to implement some things they thought about and doing things. You will never be able to do that with ASICs. You will always have to have a certain startup cost to make an ASIC. But what you do have now, you have crowdfunding, so that if you have a few bunch of people who want to make something and they contribute money, then you should be able to do it. And also you have now distributed development, not the patches that you have to post on Usenet or on a mailing list, but you have GitHub, GitLab, and all these kind of things. So if you combine things, then I think we should also be able to get ASICs running. About this, so I want to have open source ASIC. My service, yeah, will need to cost money, so it will be kind of commercial, but I'm going to talk about this proprietary open source and commercial. That's the talk, my other talk, before the food this evening. I'm now before the food in the mean. So I don't know if I have to think, search anything about that, but I'm two times before the food. So low volume open source ASIC. Now the ASIC is actually target high volume. And if you discuss about high volume, low volume for a foundry is so many hundreds of wafers. That's still low volume. So that's 50,000 chips or so, and that's still low volume. So what I'm doing is ridiculously low volume. I always say when I talk to these people, I do ridiculously low volume. And they are not interested in actually in that. They want to don't spend money on that. And you have all this mass cost, EDA tool license, engineering, IP blocks, and also the fine print is not make a foundry. The first thing they ask, please sign an NDA. And as a maker, you don't want to sign an NDA because you're bound for life. If you have a company, then you can sign it in the name of your company, but that's different. A maker doesn't want to do that. Actually, I don't want to do that. So what my target is, my dream. So I want to be able to make a full board with a custom ASIC on it, less than 100 euro, starting from 100 devices. So it's 10K per board. I think you should be able, if you see on crowdfunding sites what the money they get for games or so, I think it should be possible if you get the people wanting to do these things. I think you have to depend on open source RTL so that nobody is always reinventing the wheel. And that's also why this conference is here. A lot of people think the same thing. And then I'm not only talking about software, but also about RTL itself. And I want to have pooled different chips on one run so that you can still share cost between the different chips. I think you also will need a push button open source EDA flow for an ASIC. So I also want to have the place and route, having you give me the RTL, I do the place and route. Or you can do it yourself, but then the question is, if it doesn't work afterwards, who is then to blame and these things? So that also, when I talk to people the first day, how are you going to guarantee it will work? We'll have to see that. And you probably want to have somebody in between who wants to talk to these legal people, that you don't have to do it yourself. Also get then, who is so crazy to do these things? Who wants to do that? I always get the question, yeah, but can't you do it with an FPGA? Yes, you can do it, but likely some people don't want an ASIC and not an FPGA. I know I'm an old Amiga user. I will talk about myself a little bit more at the other presentation, but that there are people who just want to have real chips because they've re-implemented the Amiga computer on FPGAs, but some people don't like it. They just want to have a real chip. You can say, but it's just what people like. You can say, yeah, but why is the FPGA not enough? But yeah. And you only have to have a few crazy people in the world to be able to make a project. So.
Power?
Maybe, but I'm on target older, something that you can plug in the wall, and then power is not that important, I think. So, yeah. But later on, if you want to do that, but then you have to find out yourself the power, and then you have to have tools to do the power investigation. So, I will start simple, and then maybe that's later on, in a year or three, four, we can think about that. I don't know if you know Hackaday, and there you can find some crazy people. I really like reading the thing, so yeah. I don't know if what you know this. Oh yeah, I didn't. So this is a guy who discovered that you can make a full adder with two physical relays at the old time. So you can do the XOR and an AND gate. And then he built a 60-bit adder with four boards with all relays. And he even made a video on an instruction how it works and logic and these kind of things. So, and then you have another one. Yeah, it's not good visible, but that's on a cardboard. He made a 4-bit cardboard computer. So what I just want to say, I think there are people who want to do these things. And if you make it cheap enough, that they can inspire other people to give them some money to do this. Where are all the crazy people? Like I said, I'm an Amiga user. This is an accelerator that is sold at the moment for an Amiga computer. It costs 240 euros, around the same amount in pounds, I think, 200 pounds or so. It has 40 megahertz Motorola processor in it and 120 megabyte RAM. If you ask that, will you pay 200 euro for that? Nobody probably will pay for that, but there are people who pay for that. These are things that are made at the moment. You also have an FPGA computer that re-implements old computers, and it's also 200 euros. And then you have guys who make, at this moment, an Atari clone, more than 500 euros, and they have produced it. So they probably found enough people to produce it. So just all, and then I think, we have the Raspberry Pi Arduino environment. I think there are also a lot of people who want to play with things. Home automation is another thing I think about. And also robotics. I'm mainly thinking about things where the compute power is not important. Because if you want to have much compute power, you will need to go to low technology nodes, and then the startup cost becomes too big. So I want to target something that is where the compute power is not that important. So, at first, before going to making a crowdfunding with a lot of projects, I want to do a pilot project. And so this is I'm going to talk about why, what, status, and plans. So why I want to do a pilot project first is to find the. Because I think you can match these, but you have to know how these things work. So I want to find the shape of the puzzle before I try to fit the puzzle in each other. So I want to test open source tools. Probably some people will have received mails from me about tools and these things. So startup cost reduction, I want to find out what are now the real costs, because the people who now sell these things, these services, think in a business-to-business way and for the high volume, longer term. So you have to really talk to them, you have to know them to try to put it in your thing, and then also to find out the legal minefield, try to undermantle that. What I want to do is I want to stay independent from investors so that I can do what I want. Also, I will talk about this in the other presentation a little bit more. So I showed you before there is a retro, a community and boards. So my pilot project I run is called Retro Microcontroller. So what I want to do there is make a microcontroller with Z80, a MOS6502 from Commodore 64, and then a Motorola 68000 from, because I think there are people who are now playing with Arduinos that may want to have something with an instruction set they are fond of from their youth, when they were young. So I selected three cores, T80, T65, and then from the Cisco 3 project, which is an Atari, I selected the 68000. This is not final, but this is now my candidates. These cores are tested because they are used in FPGA projects where they really implement these old computers like a Commodore 64 or an Amiga. So they even tested it with the demos of Commodore 64, which are known to push these CPUs to the limit, actually, and they are debugged with that. So I know that it should work, so that I don't have to work on the cores themselves anymore to get this project running. I wanted to have a permissive license, and after the talk of Andrew, I still think that if the code is now licensed under GPL, without any exceptions, you cannot use it for an ASIC. If you want to, I want to still use the Foundry-provided standard cell library. Also, don't want to have that as a possible problem where something can go wrong. And the code that I selected happened to be VHDL. I don't know if it's coincidence, but I have found a few in Verilog, but most of them, they were copyleft licenses, and I don't want to go for copyleft. But if you have other things, I'm not bound to VDL or Verilog. Actually, I'm of the opinion that we should get rid of Verilog and VHDL both, if you want to have makers doing hardware, but that's maybe a talk for next year. So I have a first top-level RTL with the JTAG interface. I implemented the JTAG interface because the guys at my work where I work say, yeah, how are we going to test this thing? So, and then I implemented. I looked at the JTAG interface of the OpenRISC or OptinSock, but it was not really reusable. It was more for a specific use. That was my feeling. We can talk about it. Nothing is fixed, so I'm open for things. For the legal things, I implemented my own company. For example, a foundry I want to work with, the first thing that they say is you need to sign an NDA, and we only want this NDA from an incorporated company. Not from a guy who is doing this work of ours, just not under an official umbrella. So I work at IMEC. I will discuss it also in an expression. I'm discussing on then on price and all these things. And also I'm going to do a crowd supply, crowdfunding project. And then we also have stretch goals. So I want to make it possible that if we reach the next stretch goal, you can go to a lower technology, and then you can put more on-chip SRAM, for example. Or you can put flash on-chip, and note that you have to do it from an external I2C flash chip. So my plan is, so there is now a landing page on the previous slide. He doesn't want to go back, it seems. Yeah, he's slow. So that I have now a landing page on this crowd supply, so you can register your email there if you want to be notified of. I think I will also put something on the LibreCore site, Planet or so. So the plan is in November to launch the crowdfunding site, so that I have determined then the money I'm going to ask for each of the boards. if I will do separate chips of only boards, and all these things are still to be decided. So end of January, the end of the campaign. So then quarter of two in 2018 to do the tape out, and then hopefully until OrthCon next year to have them present the full, the first boards. So I need you. So support the crowdfunding campaign if you think this is nice. If you spend a few bucks there, then it can help me. If you have ideas of other software I'm not thinking about, implementation, if you want to do the placer out, okay. So that's my email address, staff@fibrasurvey.eu. The GitLab, I also put the source code now on the GitLab. And there is also crowd supply. The only thing is I'm doing this alone, off hours. So if you mail me, it can be that I don't respond immediately because I can't clone myself and I don't multitask well. I'm going to give a short demo if it works. So actually, what I use for development is called an FPGA board, the XLR8. So the XLR8, which is actually an FPGA board with a Max 10 FPGA on it. And that tries to mimic an Arduino. So it's fully Arduino compatible. So the Max 10 only has 3.3 volt I/O capability. So they level shifted all I/Os, even the analog. They put some op amps so that the 5 volt is reduced to 3.3 volt. So it should be fully Arduino compatible. And I'm using that to develop my things and to test things. And then this is just a prototype of a shield where I soldered some LEDs on it to test it. Don't look too closely because it's not, you will see that I'm not used to do these things if you look closely. Oh no, this has to be put here. So, and this is a bus pirate, which actually allows you to put JTAG interface to JTAG. So what I've now here is here is the cable. So you have here, when I put it on, you see that the lights are flashing. So that's a small program in Z80 assembly, which is included on the board. And it's not well visible. Is it? No. Voila. So it's OnCloud. No, OnCloud not. Ah, JTAG. So then I put, so SVF is a standard format to do testing through JTAG interface. So I implemented something, a play SVF, blink, and then hopefully, probably I will now get an error because I don't see what I type. No, you see that through the JTAG interface, I now use the boundary scan to flash the lights. So hopefully I can debug my chip or test the chip when it goes back from the manufacturer. I think you all understand, but people are quite skeptic if you want to make an ASIC. For a guy who only knows FPGA, at my work, they are quite skeptic about these things. But Okay, thank you. Any questions?
Has a long blog post about the costs.
Yeah, but like I said, I am working at IMEC, and we are part of Europe Practice, who provides this MPW services, so we know quite well about the costs.
Okay,
so
then,
I also have seen this guy, Matthias Tonin-Netwe, but we have good connections with the foundries, so I think I can maybe start it here.
So what, like you mentioned before, that you're not going to go to the lowest technology. So what technologies are you thinking of now to targeting?
From 0.35 to 0.18.
Okay, yeah. So that will keep the cost really down.
Yeah.
And then, isn't the packaging pretty expensive if you do like low volume chips? Or?
We are in discussion about that, but there are different options. One of the options is direct on board.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. So. But I don't want to say too much because it's recorded, and it's for lifetime. So I don't want to wake any sleeping dogs. Not needed.
And you mentioned that you want to use like a full open source EDA flow. Like, what's the current status of that? Like, is it possible?
That's one of things of the pieces to find out.
Okay.
Because I want to have them multi language even, and that will even be very difficult.
Yeah.
Because one of the problems is VHDL code, so it's I cannot use EOSIS, so I have to use the GHDL integration into EOSIS. So that's things to find out, and I can use help for that.
Yeah. But is there like PNR and SDA tools available or?
Yes. I think you have. I'm the presentation about that. There are two. You have the Grey Wolf from Tim.
Yeah.
And. It's open circuit design, it's called. And then you have also Coriolis, which is from the guys who also made Alliance.
Okay,
I'm
cool.
Looking at both of them. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So then there is food, I think. Yeah.
Thank you.